Time Warner Audiobooks presents Melted into Air, written and read by Sandi Toksvig. We should have cancelled. Gina Harper could barely believe what she was seeing. Oh, God, why didn't we cancel? Don't be ridiculous. It's going really well. Francis Angel, theatrical impresario, stood in the wings of the small regional theatre and watched the understudy Macbeth try for the fourth time in as many minutes to remove his sword from its scabbard. Even Macduff, who was a stalwart old actor of the jobbing variety, was beginning to run out of reasons not just to run the king through and be done with it. The house was fairly empty and the sound of Macbeth's plaintive panting echoed round the gallery. Gina and Francis had stood together in the wings of 100 theatres, first as children in school plays, then as university students of drama, and finally, for 20 years, as producers. Both were dark, fiery-looking women. There was more than a hint of the Mediterranean about them. Francis had more height, slim and stylish but sensible, the three S's of home county's fashion. Gina had had children, and the inevitable effect of gravity had left her the chunkier of the two. They were both, however, immaculately dressed. There was a care in their own presentation that had once been represented by the work they produced on the stage, but that was some time ago. Lately, and inexplicably, every theatrical standard available had been allowed to slip, culminating in what was proving to be a unique evening of entertainment. "I should have insisted. He doesn't know what he's doing," repeated Gina. "Nonsense," countered Francis. "He trained at RADA. As a stage manager." "In which case you'd think he could deal with the bloody sword." The King of Scotland at last managed to pull the sword from its holder. Sadly, in the excitement, he forgot the weight of the thing. The 3-foot-long weapon flew from his hand in a great arc, shot past Gina and Francis, and landed in the wings on the toe of the company manager. Gina crossed herself and briefly closed her eyes. There was, to say the least, tepid applause. A small class of GCSE students left to catch their coach, none the wiser as to why Shakespeare might ever have been considered great. Tim Allen, the theatre manager, was incandescent as they stood outside. The rain had stopped, but the streets were drenched and the tyres of the ambulance services gave a farewell splash as its lights flashed away up the anonymous high street. Now, Miss Angel, you and your sister, cousin, she's my cousin, have brought me many fine shows over the years, so I took this one on trust, but we now have no Macbeth. Gina, who had been on the phone, appeared out of the shadows. "Mr. Allen, I wonder if you might get the company together on stage." The manager shook his head and splashed back to the stage door. Francis tried to smile. "Well, that wasn't too bad." "Not too bad?" Gina was beside herself. "Francis, we have just allowed a production of Shakespeare to be performed in which the three witches were laughing so much one of them fell into the cauldron. I will not put my name to any more of this nonsense. We used to have a very good reputation." Francis tried a counterattack. "You're the bloody finance director. Look at the sodding margins. People don't want to go to the theatre anymore. We're in a dying profession and it's not my fault." "That's not true. They'll go if there's something decent to look at. No one wants to see Henry V leading a charge of soldiers consisting of two people in the wings banging a saucepan. You're abandoning everything we've worked for over the years." Francis was tired and a flash of temper erupted. "I have never abandoned anyone in my life. That is why there was a performance tonight. Don't you know that the show must go on? Maybe things wouldn't have got like this if you didn't spend so much fucking time with your kids." Both women took a deep breath. "Is that what you think?" asked Gina. "That I've let you down?" Francis shook her head. "I'm sorry. No, of course you must spend time with the girls. I thought I could manage without you, but lately I'm..." "Miss Angel, Mrs. Harper," the theatre manager called out into the street, "we're ready on stage."
"So did you get someone to step in?" whispered Francis urgently to Gina as they made their way backstage.
Gina gave a long and deeply felt sigh before she replied, "Alistair." "You're kidding, right?" Francis stopped Gina in the wings. "Why would you do that to me?" Gina had had enough. She couldn't recall why a theatrical business had ever seemed like a good idea.
It's 11 o'clock in the middle of bloody nowhere. I'm sure I could have got Ian McKellen ready for tomorrow night. Now get on stage and do what you do best. The actors, cleansed of their makeup and all inclined to believe that they were emotionally drained, stood ghost-like in the dim light of a single safety lamp. Francis took a deep breath and stepped from the dark wings, quietly applauding. Unbelievable. I've been working in the theatre for 20 years, and I have never seen a more professional, more dedicated approach by any group of actors. You had a nightmare evening, and yet your focus never wavered. Frances swept her eyes around the assembled cast. Now, I know that things have been hellish since Peter Danley was readmitted to rehab and could no longer give his king. Sadly, Peter's demons proved too strong, but how proud he will be when he knows that tonight the show went on. I know that John here, Francis nodded towards the feckless understudy, has given his all, but despite that, the situation cannot continue. Nevertheless, John, thank you. Francis led a round of applause for the man who, up until 10 minutes ago, the rest of the company had wanted to kill. Tomorrow morning, the distinguished actor, Alistair Barton, will be joining the company. This extraordinary, and may I say, very special company. Francis began to applaud again, and for reasons no one would ever be able to recall, the entire cast and the theatre manager joined in. When at last everyone, even the fragile Mr. Allen, had departed content, Francis and Gina got into the car for the long drive back to London. Gina drove for a while without speaking, until at last she said, "Mama is worried about you." Francis gave a wry smile. "Ah, the Aunt Emilia card. You haven't tried that in a long time." Gina looked at Francis out of the corner of her eye. They had grown up together. For 35 years they had shared secrets and successes. "We've been doing this for a long time, Francis. You're probably right about the kids. I thought I could do it all, and maybe I can't. But it's not just me. You need a rest. You need a change." "Change? I'm 40. The only change I have to look forward to is the kind that brings you out in hot sweats at 2 a.m. "Look, Francis, I know you don't want to talk about your beloved Alistair." Francis held up her hand to stop Gina, but it was too late. "Your beloved Alistair, much to no one's surprise, was a shit. He's an actor. They're all shits. You have a broken heart. Take a holiday." The women paused for a moment, and the silence was thick with things unsaid. "Mama thinks you need to go home," Gina said at last. Francis sat looking out of the window. "Home," she said at last. "To Bedford. No one needs to go to Bedford." "No," Gina took her time. She knew she was treading on thin ice. "To Monte Castello. Go and sort things out in your head. Go and face up to what happened." "Nothing happened," snapped Francis. "There was an accident, that's all." The car went silent. The rain beat down on the windscreen and the rhythm of the wipers lulled Francis into a reverie. Italy. The land of her birth. She tried to picture it, but there were only fragments left. A stone wall, a cypress tree, a puppy. Her puppy? Someone else's? She tried to imagine her parents. They had not been poor. The house had stood on the outer reaches of the town, looking across acres of the Umbrian countryside. Sunflowers. There had been sunflowers. Neither Francis nor Gina spoke Italian. Aunt Emilia had insisted on English. She had wanted the girls to fit in. Now Aunt Emilia was slipping slowly into the twilight of dementia. More and more she lapsed into Italian when the girls spoke to her. Francis was 5 when she had left Monte Castello and had soon forgotten her native language. The town had been in the grip of panic and her parents had spirited her away. They had feared for her life, for their own lives. She had flown wide-eyed and frightened with a brown label attached to her woolen coat. Her parents had been due to follow on. But then there had been the accident and Aunt Emilia had closed the door to Monte Castello. Francis's parents were dead. Gina reached out and touched Francis's hand. "Maybe if you sort out the past, then you can move on." "Look, I know nothing about Italy. I left Monte Castello when I was 5, for God's sake. Everyone is dead now." "Mama says Maria is still there. Quite the centre of the village, in fact." Frances took a deep breath. I can't. Gina paused before she spoke. Frances, I know you're afraid of Father Benito. Gina, leave it, warned her cousin, but Gina was on a roll. I'm sure the old priest must be long gone. It's been 35 years. I don't know anyone. Where would I stay? At Sophia Fratelli's house. Frances felt a chill. She's dead. Sophia is dead. The family sold the house to an English woman. It's a summer school now that runs art courses. Frances stared at her insistent cousin. You've already booked this, haven't you? Gina nodded. Learn to paint. Find yourself. Who the hell says I'm lost? Flashed Frances, furious at the way she was being pushed. Gina smiled. Honey, you're so lost. No one is even bothering with a search party. Trust me, we drank the brandy and gave away the St. Bernard. Frances awoke, startled and trembling. Instinctively, she reached for Alistair, but he wasn't there. He hadn't been there for over a year, yet somehow she still kept to her side of the bed. His space on the right lay empty and available. She had been dreaming. She was running and stumbling away from... Away from what? The priest? Father Benito? Had he really been so frightening that her parents had given up their only child? Tired and thick-headed, Frances took the train back to the theatre where she would oversee the rehearsals with Alistair. She felt sure her unquenchable feelings for the man would no longer engulf her. Frances was a bright and organised woman. She knew that her wasted focus on her past lover was insane. The beginning of Frances and Alistair's affair had caused a great scandal. He had been living with an extremely famous but fading screen star when Frances had hired him for a one-man tour of Oscar Wilde. She had thought nothing of it when his agent had called her to arrange a meeting with her star before a matinee. One moment, Frances had been fine and in control, and in the next, her entire being was lost to the man in front of her. It was also clichéd. Her heart had pounded, she had almost gasped for air, and her brain ceased to function properly. Alistair was a wonderful lover. He treated the act of lovemaking like any other performance, utterly confident of good reviews. It had taken a few weeks of secret trysts and frantic calls to Frances for him to leave his lover. The story was played out across the front pages of the Red Tops for weeks. Suddenly, the exchange of emotions and body fluids between Frances Angel and Alistair Barton mattered to everyone. From the beginning, her cousin had been the only one who warned her to be careful. He's an actor, she said. I don't doubt that he loves you, but not half as much as he loves himself. Frances had lasted longer than most with Alistair, but she had, perhaps, made a fatal mistake. They'd been having dinner in a favourite restaurant. It's my birthday soon, she had begun. I'm going to be 40, and I was thinking about a baby. There had been a brief moment of silence, broken only by the snap of a breadstick in Alistair's hand. Darling, you are sweet. What a funny idea. A dark little thing with an instinct for theatrics. He took a sip of wine and laughed. Can you imagine me as a father? You'd be marvellous, of course, but I'd be hopeless. It was not mentioned again. Then, a month or so later, without any further conversation, Alistair simply moved on. There was a younger, more driven woman in broadcasting. She had a lovely home and a business zeal that suggested no desire to procreate. Now, 7 years and 7 months after their first encounter, Frances once again sat on a train heading for a meeting with her leading man. It was May, but nevertheless, the flat countryside spread out grey and misty as they rattled through English towns, each more nondescript than the last. Italy, she said to herself. Italy. How ridiculous to think that she might go to Italy. The train was late and Alistair was already on stage when she arrived. He looked up and smiled. It was a dazzling smile. And so it should have been. He had spent thousands at the dentist's and many hours practising in front of the mirror. He waited for Frances to come to his embrace. Darling girl, he declared as she accepted a soft kiss on each cheek. He smelt wonderful. And in that moment, Frances was lost once more. The rehearsals went well. Alistair was good and managed to jolly the company through their paces with a nice mix of actors' anecdotes and some wonderful verse reading. Frances sat in the stalls. She'd always felt a certain magic in the theatre. But now, for the first time, she was bored. This wasn't real life. She didn't care about the damn king or his woods or the absurd witches and just wished they'd cut to the end. Alistair slipped into the red velvet seat beside her. "How's it looking, chicken?" Frances realised she had no idea how it was going. "Excellent. You're excellent." Alistair slouched further down in his seat so that his head almost touched her shoulder. "I knew you'd call," he said quietly. "I didn't," replied Frances firmly. "Gina did." "Whatever. We can't be out of each other's lives, you know that. We just needed a few months before we'd be back working together. Who'd want to break up this great partnership?" For a moment, nothing had changed. He was moving closer when his mobile phone rang. "Hello?" "Oh, hello, Pickle. No, we just finished." He moved away to take the call from his current lover. "Well, I miss you too." Alistair turned and winked at his old love. Pickle, chicken, just different forms of food on the same menu. Frances turned and ran. The homecoming of the prodigal daughter should be a glorious return in a chariot of fire. Sadly for Frances, it was in a clapped-out old Mercedes that railed and spluttered at the indignity of its last years being spent in the service of a local taxi firm. The driver was in no hurry. The chances of collecting another fare from this distant Umbrian hilltop were nil. He knew that the narrow road wound up the tall, thin incline and gave up at the town gates. Halfway between the great cities of Florence and Rome, no one passed through Monte Castello. It was not on the way to anywhere. Frances sat in the back, swaying with each bend and steeling herself for the onslaught of something familiar. She did seem to recognise the scenery, but then she had seen it in 100 films and 1 million pieces of art. She looked out across the lush Tiber Valley. After 2,000 years of human occupation, the verdant valley was in neat order with vineyards, olive groves and sunflower fields carefully framed by rows of cypresses and umbrella pines. The driver, too, spent more time on the view than safety might have suggested. His family had lived here for generations. From oxcart to Mercedes, the destiny of his people had been to haul others up and down the undulations of Italy. "Shields, mountains," he muttered, "put there by God to trouble my gearbox." At last the car drew to a shuddering halt. Frances practically fell out of the back door and energetically vomited beside a metal waste bin which hung on a medieval stone wall. It was hardly the entrance anyone with theatrical flair would have hoped for. She had no idea what had made her so unwell. Perhaps a combination of lousy airline wine, exhaustion, and selecting every outer bend on a long mountainous route had taken its toll. Frances wiped her mouth with a hanky and stood up. "I need my suitcase," she muttered. The driver remained motionless in his seat as he continued to smoke and left her to struggle with the boot of the car alone. "You've been utterly charming," Frances declared with brilliant but utterly ineffectual British sarcasm. She leant through the open car window and tossed paper money onto the passenger seat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.